Hello, my name is Trish Lynch from IOHR TV. It's good to have you with us. Now, today we have taken NGO Focus on the road from London to Geneva. Today we're going to be meeting with Caroline Dulliez, who is head of projects at the International Committee for the Red Cross. The ICRC was established way back in 1863 to help people affected by conflict. They have a staff of almost 16,000 human rights defenders, and they operate under the banner of neutrality to save lives in some of the most challenging and life-threatening situations worldwide. Let's now go to the studio to hear more about the work of the ICRC heroes. Caroline, great to have you with us. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Good morning, Trish.
Can you tell me how many countries have signed up to the Geneva Convention of 1864, which demands the protection of victims of war? Can you tell us a little bit more about the convention itself, and to what extent do nations actually adhere to it?
The Geneva Conventions have been reworked on at different times in history, and the latest Geneva Conventions date from 1949. There are four of them. There are also two additional protocols that were signed in the 70s. There are 196 states that have signed these conventions. So basically all the states in the world have signed the Geneva Conventions, which makes it a hugely important body of law that applies to conflict, that brings limits and a dose of humanity in situations that are tragic. But our job at the ICRC is to keep repeating and promoting this body of law, and on the ground to make sure as much as possible that it is applied, because this is what alleviates suffering.
Now, you operate in more than 80 countries, and mostly to assist war-torn nations and the people who are affected by that conflict. Can you explain what kind of assistance the ICRC provides in these kind of situations?
The mission of the ICRC is to protect and assist victims of war. The needs of victims of war are multiple. We work to bring life-saving assistance, like water, like food, like healthcare. But we also work to ensure that the law is applied, that the law is respected, and that protected groups are really protected. And that's wounded, sick, the medical mission, the medical structure, those who work to save lives. Mm-hmm. It's the prisoners, the detainees in prisons. It's all the civilian population, those that are not taking part in the conflict. All these must be respected and protected. So our job is to monitor the situation, but also enter in a dialogue, a humanitarian dialogue with parties to a conflict.
I also read that 25 years after the conflict in Bosnia-Herzegovina, more than 6,000 families are still looking for information about their families and loved ones. Can you tell us what is the nature of the work that you do with missing persons? Because a lot of people might think that it's only related to recent conflicts, but in actual fact, you go back too, don't you?
The first thing that you think of when you've gone through a crisis is, where is my loved one? Is he or she safe? Today, there are hundreds of thousands of people missing in the world because of conflict, but not only, because of other forms of violence, other situations of violence, because of disasters, or because of migration today, which adds on to the tragedy. There is an increase of cases globally. You mentioned Bosnia, years after the conflict, but Colombia, 79,000 persons missing. Iraq, the estimations are between 250,000 and 1 million people missing. Migration today, the IOM figures are more than 30,000 since 2015. So the cases, the numbers are increasing globally. Ourselves, the ICRC, we have today 100,000 tracing demands, requests by families searching for loved ones. This is the highest caseload we've had in 10 years. And I'm talking about figures, but you have to understand that behind each of these numbers, it's a family that's affected. It's a whole community. And the consequences of having a missing relative are absolutely terrible. In my own experience, 20 years in humanitarian missions, I've seen literally families destroyed by this. Everywhere I was. My first mission in Sri Lanka 20 years ago, I remember these mothers of soldiers missing in action, I've seen in the Balkans families desperate for news. I've seen in Iraq the wives of men who had been disappeared, carrying along for their kids.
Is there any story that you can share with us?
There are. There are many of these stories. There are regularly families that are reconnected by the work that we do together with the Red Cross and Red Crescent societies all over the world. The activities that we developed are very, very numerous. So yes, there are people that are found, you know, because we have visited a prison and we have taken a message from a prisoner who had not been able to inform his family. And we bring this message sometimes miles and miles after a long field trip to a family who suddenly understands that he is not dead. I have this memory of this old man that I met in Kosovo. Three sons had disappeared. He was telling me every morning I wake up, I think the first thing I think is, what more can I do? What else could I ask? Where else could I go to find information? Every time someone knocks at the door, I'm thinking it's them. You know, families, they're in limbo. They cannot go on. They cannot live on with their lives. And then there is the psychological suffering, but there is also economic tragedy, because often it's the breadwinner that's gone missing.
Yeah.
And families have to suddenly often pay everything they can to find information. They fall prey to rumors. They fall prey to people who use their pain for money.
Yeah. IOHR broke the news 2 weeks ago that there's a British family in London who are trying to find and repatriate their three-year-old grandson, who's a little boy called Salman, after his father died fighting alongside ISIS in Syria. Now, our director, who's Valerie PA, she accompanied the grandfather to the British Red Cross office in London, where he was interviewed in some depth. Can you tell us what is the extent of the cooperation that you have between the ICRC and the local Red Cross offices that you have around the world? And hypothetically speaking, what could the Red Cross and this family now do to try and find this little boy and bring him back to his family?
All of them, together with us, are a network, and we can work together to be able to find information on people who register their cases with this network. The activities are very diverse. And beyond the case of this little boy, which is absolutely terrible, and there are many other
stories like this.
That are happening at this time. But the work of the movement, and the ICRC in particular, right during a crisis, is already to try to restore family ties very quickly. And that's done with messages, with ensuring that people can have access to phones, can call quickly to give information. That's the first work to be done. But also visits to prisoners in prisons can also help to restore the links. And then there is all the work that has to be done, field work, but also piecing pieces of a puzzle from the elements that the family has by going to visit the last address where the person was. So all of these elements get together to try to find information. And then there is the work to be done with parties to a conflict or authorities in a country that also have access to information. And also later on, and that's more of a sad thing, but it's also needed, we have developed forensic services to be able to identify human remains when it's the case.
Are there more resources needed in this area to help local authorities and doctors to actually identify those unidentified remains?
I think, yes, there is a whole evolution of these techniques. I mentioned that, you know, at the very beginning, when Henri Dunant created the Red Cross through this defining moment he had at the Battle of Solferino, he did work on evacuating the wounded. This was in 1859, but he also took messages from dying soldiers to bring to their families. So this was, at the very beginning, messages. If you go to the Red Cross and Red Crescent Museum, you see these number of cards. The 7 million files that were created during the World War I to reconnect families.
7 million.
7 million.
Wow, that's
files.
A number, isn't it? Mm-hmm. 7 million.
But these were small cards, handwritten. These were messages in writing. Today, we use phones. We use satellite phones. We use online services. We have developed the Trace the Face, which is an online tool where families can post a picture and reconnect through the website. We're working to develop search algorithm to be able to work on different databases which are disconnected. We're looking at facial recognition softwares. We're developing a number of new tools.
ICRC conducts prison visits to protect the rights of detainees, something that we know that you have excelled at since 1870. Can you tell us if you visited any prisons in Syria? And if so, how were you received once you got there? Were you allowed to have time freely with prisoners? And what is the protocol? How do you record any possible torture when you're in a prison? Are you allowed to document these things?
Yeah, we have had access to prisons in Syria, but beyond Syria, we are visiting a large number of detention places all over the world in more than 80 countries. We have a very clear procedure when we visit prisons, and we apply systematically the same process. We have interactions with the authorities in the prison to explain what we do. We have access to the lists of people who are present in the prison. We ask and we request to be able to have private interviews with detainees so we can have an idea of what they are going through.
And is that always possible? Is it sometimes yes, sometimes no?
This is a systematic request, and the ICRC will probably prefer not to visit if its process is not respected, because this is key to have a good understanding of what are the problems in the prison. You need to speak with the authorities, you need to speak with the detainees, and the detainees need to be sufficiently at ease to say what
they
have to
say. Free to speak the truth.
Free to speak, including about ill treatment. And once we have been able to also visit all the premises to see what is this prison like, what are the places where food is being done, where people can wash, where people can have access to fresh air, we can have an idea of what are the problems. And then we can have a dialogue with the authorities, or with the national authorities beyond the prison authority, to improve situations if there is a need.
And it's not just political prisoners that you represent, is it, that you go to visit?
Our first mandate is to have access to people who are detained because of a conflict. But of course, when you visit a prison, you don't always have only people who have been arrested because of the conflict or because of political reasons. So we have what we call an all detainee approach, which means we're not going to discriminate in our service between all of those that are in the prison.
Can you tell us what the impact is of recent conflicts on water and sanitation systems? And as you said earlier, that you do provide clean water to communities. What can you tell us about that?
There are fundamental needs and fundamental infrastructure that are sometimes affected by a conflict. And this is why we are able to develop a number of services, from bringing water through trucks in remote areas that do not have access, to digging wells when there is a need, to also repairing very, very big urban infrastructures, because this is increasingly what we are seeing. The conflicts today are very much taking place in urban settings. Mm-hmm. So you're not just facing the need to dig a well or bring trucks of water. You need to repair whole systems, which are very huge. So this is increasingly what we've been doing, and we are able to adapt to that.
And when you're operating in a conflict zone where terrorist groups are active, do they let you in? Are they cooperative, or is it difficult?
The work of the ICRC has always been to work through dialogue. The only thing we can do, the only thing protecting us, is our emblem. We do not have guns, we do not have flak jackets, we have our emblem to protect ourselves. And the only way that we can have access to a place is to be understood and respected.
Now, you said there just a moment ago that you just wear the bib with the Red Cross logo on the front, that you don't wear a flak jacket like many journalists who have that added protection. Mm. Why not?
Because this is what neutral, impartial and independent action can be. It's about being accepted. It's about being understood and let go and let have access to places, to people. If we don't have that, we do not want to be seen as maybe confused with arm carriers, for example, or other actors that are not neutral. This is the only way we can preserve this perception, which is the basis of our acceptance. But so, you know, it's a circle. Yeah. You cannot do a step forward in that direction without losing everything else. So it's it is risky, yes. And we have tragedies.
And you've lost a few people. A few people have been kidnapped.
Yeah.
But this is your symbol of who we are. We're here to do good. We're here to bring peace to this area.
And these are always tragic moments for our staff, first of all, those who pay with their lives or with their freedom, and for their families, and for all of us, because every single staff that is harmed in his work, it's a piece of us which is harmed.
Yeah. Caroline, we'd like to thank you for sharing the incredible work that ICRC are doing, not just here in Switzerland, but globally. So thank you for coming to share with us that amazing story.
Thank you very much for having me.
You're welcome. And thank you for joining us for another episode of NGO Focus. Don't forget, you can see other episodes on our website. So until next time, from myself, Trish Lynch, goodbye.